We're speaking with David Grisman. You have to check out the website, acousticoasis.com, and Acoustic Disc.
Please do, yeah.
Yeah, the company itself. And before we wrap this up, we've got to speak about Jerry Garcia and your feeling about the day that he left the world. And first off, where did you meet Jerry? And can you give us your gut feeling about how that went when you first met Jerry Garcia?
I met Jerry at a place called Sunset Park in West Grove, Pennsylvania, in the summer of 1964, and that's one of the places I used to hitchhike to, in where every Sunday in the summer they would usually have a bluegrass band or two. And that particular Sunday, Jerry had traveled all, he was on a pilgrimage from the West Coast to hear bluegrass music, and we both were there to hear Bill Monroe. We met in the parking lot and did a little picking, and it was kind of, back in those days, there was very small pockets of like-minded, kind of kindred spirits of essentially urban kids who were interested in authentic American folk music of various traditions, blues, old-time, bluegrass, country. Jerry and I were kind of members of that club, although he was from the West Coast and I was from the East Coast, and we had heard about each other and we had mutual friends, and we kind of hit it off and had a lot of common things in common, interests in common, and we stayed in touch. And the next summer, 65, was the first time I went out to the West Coast and hung out mostly in Palo Alto, California, where the Grateful Dead was just starting. And they were actually called the Warlocks.
Right.
And I will take credit for getting them first national press, because the aforementioned Israel G. Young, the guy I worked for in Greenwich Village, wrote a column for Sing Out magazine called Frets and Frails, which was kind of like a news, you know, what's happening kind of column.
Right.
And if you go back to sometime in the fall of 65, you'll find in one of those columns, David Grisman just came back from California, where he met the Warlocks, and they were an interesting group because they were combining rock and roll with bluegrass and traditional folk music, which they were. I went to some of their first gigs. They were playing around people's swimming pools.
Huh. How about that?
Yeah.
It was an interesting venue.
But, you know, Jerry and I had this mutual love for bluegrass music, and that ultimately, after I moved, actually, that's one reason that I moved to California. I was playing in a band called Earth Opera, and we just finished a tour in Southern California, and I decided to visit a friend in Northern California, and this friend told me there was a softball game the next day in Marin County between the Jefferson Airplane and the Grateful Dead, and so went down there to see Garcia, and when I saw him, he said, "Hey, we're working on this album. Could you come in and do some overdubs on it?" And that was American Beauty. So I kind of figured, "Wow, I just came up to San Francisco for a weekend, and I already got a gig."
Wow.
So that was kind of a factor, and maybe I should move out here.
Wow. I'm so glad I asked you that question. I mean, these stories should be put down on tape like they are today and kept and archived over the years, because, I mean, later on in history...
Well, maybe someday when I'm in a chair hooked up to something, I'll do my memoirs. But, you know, I've enjoyed living the life. I don't really need to... I got a lot of stories.
Yeah, over the years. Mm-hmm. So throughout that time, throughout all the years, you kept in touch with Jerry in various different ways, shapes, and forms, I take it?
Yeah, although, actually, after Olden in the Way, we kind of parted ways for about 13 years.
Right, right.
And then we got back together, and in a big way, got together, mostly to record, which was his idea, which continued till his death. In fact, I did his last recording with him in my studio in July of 95.